Welcome to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting. We're here tonight at the Joint at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, showcasing the best fighters and bringing you the most exciting mixed martial arts action in the world. On the show tonight, in the light heavyweight division, Brian All-American Stan faces Steve Robot Cantwell. In the welterweight division, John Natural Alessio takes on the natural-born killer, Carlos Condit. Also in the welterweight division, powerful striker Eric Bad Apple versus submission specialist Brock Larson. And one more in the welterweight division, Tiki Gosen faces Dave the Bionic Terrell. And the WEC featherweight title is on the line in our featured fight of the night. Urijah the California Kid Faber takes on the triangular strangler, Joe Pearson. Welcome to WEC Wrekcage.
The Joint at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino in beautiful Las Vegas, Nevada, home of the World Extreme Cage Fighting. Tonight, it's Wrekcage WEC style. And hello once again, everyone. Todd Harris along with the champ, Frank Mir. Frank, what can the fans expect to see tonight?
These are some of the best MMA fighters in our sport right now. You're going to see great striking, jiu-jitsu, wrestling, and ground and pound.
All right, let's take a look at codes of the cage. Ways to win here at the WEC, three judges score the bout. The bout duration, 3 5-minute rounds. Championship fights, 5 5-minute rounds. A 10-point must system is in effect, with the round winner gaining 10 points. His opponent, 9 or less, based on effective striking, grappling, aggression, and of course, cage control. Our first matchup, a light heavyweight bout. Brian Stan bringing a record of 2-0, his strengths, athleticism, and strength. He will be taking on Steve Cantwell, 205 pounds, 20 years of age, out of Las Vegas, Nevada. Both these men extremely strong, Frank.
Yeah, you know, I've actually got to train a little bit with Brian Stan. Got to see his athletic ability. He is a very strong athlete. Steve Cantwell seems to be, so it's going to be an interesting event between the two fighters.
Brian Michael Stan, I'm a First Lieutenant of the United States Marine Corps, currently with 3rd Battalion, 2nd Marines.
I respect the fact that Brian Stan's a Marine, but unfortunately for him, I already fought the toughest Marine, you know, my dad growing up.
I'm dedicating this fight to 4 of my Marines that died in this past deployment. Lance Corporal Co-Prince, Lance Corporal Champlin, Lance Corporal Brown, and Lance Corporal Martinez. All 4 died with me fighting in combat for their country and for their fellow Marines, so this fight and everything I do in this fight is for them.
Dad, dedicate this fight to you. You know, unfortunately, I'm gonna have to kick a Marine's ass to do it. So, hoorah.
Well, if Steve wants to use the Marine Corps slogan of hoorah, then I'm gonna teach him what it's all about, because he has no right to say it, because he's not a Marine, whether his dad was or not. He's not a Marine. He's gonna find out what facing a Marine is all about tonight.
Well, as we go to the tail of the tape, the motivation certainly with Brian Stan, dedicating this fight to his 4 fallen comrades. 26 years of age, 6'1", is Stan. Steve Cantwell, 20 years of age, 6'2". And Frank, I don't think we've ever had a bout like this with so much motivation on the line for one fighter, as in First Lieutenant Brian Stan.
Yeah, you know, I mean, as fighters, you know, you have your reasons for why you walk in the ring and why you do things, and those are what get you through bad times. And I don't think I've heard of one of a more noble cause, really. I mean, it's very motivating and very inspiring.
All right, we are set to go from the Joint in Las Vegas, Nevada. This is light heavyweight World Extreme Cage Fighting.
You ready?
Brian Stan in the white trunks, Steve Cantwell in the red trunks, and it is on.
Nice inside leg kick to try to counter the jab. See already, Steve Campbell's using a little more Muay Thai, a little more traditional style. See him doing the jabs, the kicks right there. That's the outside of the thigh, trying to hit the sciatic nerve. It looks like Brian Stans. A little more of a boxing outlook here. Oh, okay.
Going for a little combination there. Stan on the aggressor right now. Both men trading punches, going toe-to-toe. And he drops him quickly, and he's going to step in. Josh Rosenthal is going to step in and stop this.
It's a nice right hand right behind the chin. Caught you. Hits that nerve. You go down.
Let's take a look at this one more time, because that was some of the best 10 seconds of fighting we've seen in a long time.
It was. Good exchange. Both guys firing off. Decent head movement going there. Left hook falling with the right hand coming right behind the ear. Brian Stan did a good job. Again, see, moving ahead just enough to keep out of the blows of his opponent. And that hand came right behind, over the top of the left hand, fired right into the jaw.
Brian Stan gets the victory. We send it now into the octagon. Joe Martinez for the official results.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, 41 seconds of round number one, your winner by technical knockout and still undefeated from Scranton, PA, Brian Stan.
Coming up next, John the Natural Alessio takes on the natural-born killer, Carlos Condit.
John Alessio's in for a world of pain.
Carlos can't beat me on his best day.
Alessio and Condit, next on WEC Wrekcage. Welcome back to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting, showcasing the best fighters and bringing you the most exciting mixed martial arts action in the world.
The welterweights take to the cage for the vacant welterweight title in the WEC. Will it be the natural or the natural born killer?
Winning the WEC title means the world to me right now. John Alessio's in for a world of pain. When he steps in there, we're gonna really see how much he wants this title.
I wanna finish Carlos. I do not want this fight to go to the judges at all. He's gonna get stopped, whether TKO or submission, it's gonna be over.
I guarantee he takes one of my knees on his chin, he's going down.
I got more power than Carlos Condit, hands down. I can hit harder than him. If it goes to the ground, I'm gonna twist him up like a noodle.
I'm walking away with that belt. John Alessio's going to the hospital.
I'm gonna ground and pound his ass out, and if he gives up a submission, I'm gonna take a limb.
The greatest moment of my life so far will be holding this belt above my head while John Alessio's still on the ground being tended to by his cornermen and knowing that I put him down and shut him up.
Carlos can't beat me on his best day.
This fight's gonna end, and it's gonna end violently.
Carlos Condit, when he steps into the cage, absolutely means business, bringing a professional MMA record of 19-4. He is only 22 years of age, and he already has 23 professional fights. And John Alessio is 170 pounds of rock-solid man. Alessio in the cage, Condit in the cage, as we take a look at the tail of the tape. Well, there you see the difference. Age 6 years, 3 inches in height to Condit, equal on the weight, 3.5 inches to the reach. This should be a fantastic battle for the vacant WEC World Welterweight belt. Both men want it. Only one is leaving the desert with it. John the Natural Alessio, Carlos the Natural Born Killer Condit.
All right, here we go.
We are scheduled for 5 rounds.
Let's get it on. Come on.
Going to fight this big, how much of a feeling out phase do you see?
I think both guys at this level are going to not necessarily feel each other out by throwing moves that don't count, but they're definitely looking for their opportunity while they're walking side to side, looking to see how their opponent's moving. Is he moving flat-footed? Is he on his toes? Is he looking like, you know, like right there, he's coming close? Oh, nice block with the knee. Looks right now, John Alessio looks like he's an option for the striking game. He's keeping it up on his feet, very calm, very relaxed, looking for an opportunity. Carlos, a little more, you can tell he has a harder time keeping his energy down. You know, he wants to fight.
Yep.
He's trying to make this a fight right now and mix it up.
Both fighters won by submission in their last fight.
John is completely a very calm and cerebral fighter. He was able to get the body lock, he came on the side, he was able to block the hips and elevate it nicely. Condit doing an excellent job of getting back into the closed guard. Oh, nice sweep to a mount. Oh.
Missed opportunity for Condit.
Yeah, he had him caught. John Lesser made a mistake having both feet together when he stood up. Honda grabbed the ankles, kicked forward, almost got the mount off of it. John Alessio recovered from that mistake. Nice, again, takedown. Head inside single, caught it more off of the kick. Little foot sweep to get it down. See if John pushes the pass to guard this time. Opting to do a standing pass. Gotta walk. Honda's so tall. Honda did a great job. Oh, there's the knees. Carlos Condit through the right hand, he's looking for that knee, he's looking for a home for it. If at any moment John Alessio makes a mistake and ducks down between to avoid that punch, he's going to eat that knee. John needs to mix it up. A little too, you know, is he fighting to go five rounds? I don't know.
Carlos Condit in the red trunks, John Alessio in the black and white trunks. This for the WEC World Welterweight belt. Nice shot from Condit.
Again, yeah, it was a nice faked up high. He brought up John's hands, delivered the roundhouse right into the ribs.
You talk about Alessio being a cerebral fighter. Is he looking for his mark right now? Is he looking for that opening?
He is. He's looking for the takedowns. He's looking for the opportunities. He's already gotten two takedowns here. He's working for his third. Got a good head inside single. Broke his hands. Let's see if he can cover the hips, though. He's already passed the guard. Oh, great job here. Carlos Condit doing a great job, too, of running up the thing. He's going to try to see if he can use the fence to get out of this. Let's see what Alessio does with, though. He's getting pushed back into the guard. That's the only problem. John Alessio's left hand's not firing elbows either. I don't know if he's wake up. There we go. His left hand's starting to move. Got pushed back into the closed guard again. Condit doing a great job. Let's see if John Alessio makes the same mistake of standing up too high again. See how his feet are spread out? A little bit better. You should still have 1 foot staggered back.
Yep. And using
got
the
caught
cage.
Again.
Quick recover by Alessio. Condit on his feet, throwing the knees.
Condit likes that right knee, the clinch.
Less than 1 minute to go here in round number one. We are scheduled for five.
John Alessio a little too passive. You know, great, you know, he's relaxed. I mean, I don't know, you know. This is one of those things where the strategy, you know, the outcome of this fight is going to dictate whether this was a smart strategy or not.
And you're right, Alessio doesn't seem to be in any hurry.
No, not
measuring out every throw, every punch, every strike. Seconds left here in round number one.
Standing Kimura. That's nice. You see Condit switched over, went for the Kimura. John Alessio went to exchange his hands between the legs.
Less than 10 seconds to go, round number one.
Condit just laying on the kick.
Round two coming up next.
Welcome back to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting.
We are ready to go with round number two between Carlos, the natural-born killer Condit, and John, the natural Alessio. Let's go inside the cage.
You ready? You ready? Let's get it on. Come on.
This is round number two, WEC World Welterweight Division. We have a vacant belt. Both men have designs on leaving Las Vegas with that belt. Condit continuing to go to the strikes, using the kicks. And it's almost like you're waiting for Alessio to wake up and just unleash.
Yes, yeah, I don't want to say it, but yeah, it's like, oh. Oh, John's, he's getting his opportunities. He's gotten some takedowns. Just on the feet, he just seems like he's not really pressing the issue. He's not, I mean, it's obvious on his feet he's not looking for a knockout. And then, but okay, so now, okay, what is he doing right here now? That's what we got to see, you know. Is he going to pass the guard? You know, both times he's been past the guard, he's got put back in it.
I I gotta say right now, Carlos Condit is definitely pushing the pace here.
Oh, Carlos Condit wants to fight.
Watch the elbow, watch where it's going, watch where it comes from, John.
There's no question in anybody's mind that Carlos is here to make this a fight. I don't think he's trying to, by no means, is the judge's decision in this guy's mind.
John Alessio on top, hailing from Canada, now fighting in Las Vegas, Nevada. Carlos Condit from Albuquerque, New Mexico, in the red trunks.
John Alessio doing a good job of trying to get his head up. Condit doing a good job of controlling it. They're both knowing what they got to do what they have, you know, to win this position. See how John's up there? Carlos, nice. John's getting his head back again, controlling the biceps.
Going Carlos to the elbows.
He is. He's using the elbows to the body, too, which will pay dividends as far as wrecking on the conditioning of Carlos Condit, but also it's going to open up the head maybe for the strikes.
Great pace of this fight. Carlos Condit getting a lot of shots in on his back. Both men now back on their feet with 250 remaining here in round number two. Big shot from Condit.
We heard that all the way from here.
Ooh.
Nice right hand, right to the body, right roundhouse to the body. Condit's really just, you know, he's winning on the feet right now. He's putting on a great display of just a good, even mixture of hands to kicks. John Alessio's hands, you know, he's not committing.
Alessio
caught a little bit on the forearm, but the energy of that kick definitely traveled through. You've seen the reaction, John. Immediately, John Alessio came in and tried to close up on a shot. Did not want to take any more abuse. Here he is, he's snatching up. He's doing more of a snatch single right there, taking the back. Oh, he got stuck in the Kimura. Now he's on his back.
Do you think Alessio's given up on the stand and striking? He's just going to take this thing to the ground?
Yeah, I think that's what his game plan is, but then the only problem with that is every time he's hit the ground, he's just not winning the fight. He's not losing, but it's even. Right there, you've seen he almost had the back. He almost got stuck in the Kimura. That's where we are, right here. Carlos doing a good job of raining down on some abuse. John Alessio needs to control the head. See, Carlos Condit's head's coming up. He gets hit. Every time he has his head controlled, it's coming down. Carlos is pushing hard to pass the guard. Push the
Carlos. Oh. Alessio just avoids a big elbow. And the knees are coming. The knees are coming from Carlos Condit.
Carlos Condit, I just see him getting stronger right now. He's getting more confident every minute of this fight. John Alessio needs to find a solution right now. Backing up the way he is with no aggressive response is just not the answer to win this fight. He's going to get caught with a bad knee, or backing up, he's going to get caught with a kick.
Wow. It's amazing how high Condit can bring those knees.
He is. Those chipping knees right there, they don't tend to knock too many people out. You just see how his hips are staying down. Right. His knees, those knees will knock someone out. That's vicious. John Alessio's in a lot of trouble. Oh, Kimura! Again, Condit going for the standing Kimura. He's rolling down. Let's see if he can pull it out. On top of the half guard. John Alessio's in a lot of trouble right now.
The only thing working on John Alessio's side right now is the clock as we approach 10 seconds remaining here in round two.
In the lion kill. Figure four body lock. Yeah. He's stuck in the choke. Can he hold on for the few seconds?
That's it. That is it. Big John McCarthy says enough. 1 second before the horn comes. And it is Carlos Condit, the natural born killer, that ends it.
Great warrior. I mean, all around, that was great stand-up, great wrestling. I mean, on the ground, great jiu-jitsu. I can't believe he finished that fight with 10 seconds left in the lion kill. Here he is, he's working, he's attacking the neck. A lot of fighters right now would just have accepted that, you know, I don't have enough time. He viciously attacked that neck.
So it is Carlos Condit out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, who gets the victory over John Alessio. We go inside the cage. Joe Martinez has the official decision.
Your winner by submission from rear naked choke and new WEC welterweight champion, the natural born killer, Carlos
Coming up next, Eric Bad Apple takes on Brock Larson. And later tonight, in the featured fight of the night, the California kid, Urijah Faber, looks to defend his featherweight title against Joe Pearson. You're watching WEC Wrekcage. Welcome back to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting.
It's all about the welterweight. Brock Larson brings a record of 21-1 into the ring against Eric Apple at 9-0. Who do you like in this one, Frank?
You know, a lot of experience between the two fighters. Eric Apple, you know, a little few less fights. Brock Larson has a big experience, but you know, Eric Apple, with that Marco Ruas background, that team has a lot of experience.
People expect me to win every fight, you know, and absolutely dominate, especially because of my history of dominating. It's going to be nice to have the world see Brock Larson beating up a pretty boy. You know, I don't feel like I have anything to lose. I think the pressure is on my opponent, Brock Larson. He's undefeated. I'm going to give him his first loss. Everybody loses, and I'm where it starts.
Brock already has admitted and, you know, spoken about that he doesn't really want to trade hands with me or trade kicks with me, and he's a wrestler. That's what he does.
I've never said that I can't stand with him.
He's going to be in trouble every second we're on the feet. I'm looking to find that chin and touch it, and that's all I got to do is touch it a couple times, and the fight's over.
I hit like a truck, and I grapple like a gorilla, so we'll see what he's got.
Hits like a truck and grapples like a gorilla. That, my friends, is a first. There you see the tail of the tape, the reach advantage going to Brock Larson. Eric Apple, 170, 6 feet tall, so give him the slight edge, but this one should absolutely be a gem as we go inside the cage. All right, we are set to go. This is a welterweight bout. You are looking at Brock Larson. He is going head-to-head with Eric Apple, who brings in a professional MMA record of 9-0. But give the nod to Larson with experience, 22 fights.
Another good thing, too, Brock Larson setting up in the southpaw stance. One thing that enables him from a southpaw shooting on an orthodox guy, that head inside single is very easy to pick up. So Bad Apple Eric is going to have to really watch his left leg. Oh, you know, he caught a straight left and retaliated out of emotion. That might have just got him clinched up pretty tight. Brock Larson doing a good job pressing down. Oh, nice ankle pick, switch off to the inside leg ride. Nice takedown. Guillotine's not on quite. Good job, oh. Brock Larson. No, right now he's passed to the side. He's safe. He can't get choked from there. But if he gets, he's doing a good job of passing his guard. If you pass your legs, the opposite right side your head is, you're safe.
Brock Larson right now seems to be pushing the pace here.
Good job. Yeah, he passed on, put his hips to the left, and now he's doing a good job staying in the half guard. That's heavy hips. Oh, he just gave up the back. Let's see if Brock Larson can sink it in his left hook. Yep, left hook just went in. Now he's going to work the neck. Eric Apple's in a bad position.
So what does the Bad Apple have to do to get out of this?
He got to wrist control. Make sure he doesn't get choked again. See, right now, the right hand is not being attacked at all. It's not being threatened. He needs to get his hands into the match. With that, he's pushing the elbow over the face. That can help. If that hand gets behind the head, he's going to get choked. Right now, he's safe. You see how it's on the chin?
Right, right. It's not deep enough.
No, I mean, you can get your jaw broken there, but you're not going to pass out. Brock Larson actually now has to go ahead and get that choke deeper. He's settling it in. And Brock Larson needs to get control of an arm and spin his hips out. He needs to square up with his opponent.
Is Larson in jeopardy of losing this position?
No, he's in a
Big
break.
John says stand him up.
I don't think so, because you know what? You're in a threat the whole time in that position. You've seen in previous fights, I've seen guys stay in that position for 4 minutes. Great job. Going for a heel hook here. Going off to the toe hold.
Oh, Apple's
nice.
Got it.
He has a good foot lock right now. Brock Larson's standing up on it. The only thing is that Eric Apple needs to control his other leg to really get leverage. See how he's up on top?
Right.
Brock Larson's not really in too much of a threat. He's gonna get rained down on punches here in a second. Oh, there they come. Here comes the left hands. Yeah, see, Brock Larson, if he gets spun off to his shoulder, though, he's in trouble. He stays on top, he's safe. App, he's safe. He needs to watch for reverse triangle. Brock Larson just needs a surfboard now. Stay on top, right. Heavy hips. Find openings and just drill hard down. He's getting caught in another toe hold. I like that move.
All right, how has Eric Apple improved his position?
He needed to go ahead and, you know what, the way he locked it up, he needed to get, use the foot lock also to sweep Brock Larson down. Right now, he's not in a good position. He's on the, you know, he was going from the top from the bottom, and it just wasn't enough leverage from there. He needed to put himself in a position to increase his leverage on top. Brock Larson doing great jiu-jitsu. Need a belly right there. See how he's sticking his left knee in the hip, controlling him? Brock Larson doing a good job. There he goes. A switch of an armbar. Armbar attempt right now. Oh. Oh, Kimura, switch off. Beautiful. Oh, he's done. He's in a pull. Oh. Eric Apple's done a great job. See how the hand between his legs? He's controlling it.
Right.
Brock Larson rips it out. It's over with it. That hand gets past his stomach. This fight's done.
Eric Apple right now in a very precarious situation.
Tap, tap,
Brock
tap,
Larson,
tap.
And he has to tap out. Brock Larson gets him into that armbar, and Eric Apple had no choice.
Great jiu-jitsu. Here's the knee to belly. He's going to switch off for the arm attacks. He's going to attack Eric Apple's right arm. He switched off. He's going to sink the right foot over the top, switch it off to a Kimura. Now here he's on top. See how he went for the submission? If he would have went from the bottom, he wouldn't have had it. He swept him, got on top. Now he's in a superior position for leverage. Once that hand gets ripped through, this fight's over.
Brock Larson said he would come in and he would end this one quickly. He hands Eric Apple his first professional defeat. Brock Larson, your winner.
Coming up next, Tiki Gosin is gunning for a knockout as he takes on David Terrell in a welterweight matchup. And later tonight, in the featured fight of the night, the California kid, Urijah Faber, looks to defend his featherweight title against the dangerous Joe Pearson. This is WEC Wrekcage. Welcome back to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting, coming to you from the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas.
There is the tail of the tape. Give the reach advantage to Tiki Gosin. Dave Terrell, 28 years of age, 169 pounds. This is welterweight fighting, three rounds scheduled.
You ready to fight? You ready? Let's do it.
As I say, no love lost, huh?
Wow, this is big right off the bat. Dave Terrell goes right at him. Tiki. Tiki's got a bit of anger in there, doesn't he?
He does. He fights with a lot of emotion. You know, some fighters that works for him. That was good there. You've seen that Dave used the right, left. He used his lead hand to go ahead and lock up a body lock, but then Tiki did a great job of pulling through. He's not letting him get in on his hips. Nice straight right hand.
Tiki's aggression and the way he's pushing the pace, it really seems like it's got Dave off balance right
now.
Oh,
it does. Ooh. Dave doesn't worry about his hands. He's going for the... I think Dave Terrell... Let's get his hands up a little bit there. Tiki's starting to see that there's a chance of catching a head kick there. You don't want to take any of those.
Watch those knees, guys. Keep it clean.
It's Dave Terrell in the camouflage. Tiki Gosin in the black and red trim.
Tiki doing a great job of keeping him back with the left hand. Really just scoping him down like a sniper with that right hand. See a red spot maybe about Dutch Terrell's temple, maybe a shot. Oh, nice straight left hand through.
Wow.
Two good shot exchanges there on Dave Terrell's side.
Finding a good combination there.
He is. He's getting stuck in a little front headlock action. Tiki using it good. That's good counter wrestling right there. You see, I wasn't really using it to take him down, but he used it to make sure that he didn't get taken down. Dave Terrell pushed him against the cage. Tiki doing a great job of just keeping him off his hips. I mean, this is really just a phenomenal way of to see how a striker, what he needs to do to keep the fight on its feet. Tiki's doing everything perfect. Dave Terrell, you know, he's doing everything too. He's working, he's looking for the takedowns, you know. His right hand's, you know, a little problematic, but I think Tiki's gonna aim a few low left kicks to the outside of that right thigh, and he might come up high.
Great exchanges.
There are. I think I would give, you know, the...
Wow. Tiki just seems so intent on pushing the pace here in round number one.
He is doing a good job, you know. Dave Terrell's definitely backpedaling, trying to be a sniper himself. Scoring real well with that straight left hand right through. I see blood coming from both opponents' face. Tiki, you know what? The Tiki's doing so great right now. He's just doing a phenomenal job of keeping David off his hips. Right now, David was able to switch to a head inside single. See if he can do anything with it. Tiki doing a good job putting pressure on the head. See how he's scooping the head down? He's putting all that pressure. Look at David's back right now. His hips are out, his head back is flat. That is fatigue. Oh, that was a beautiful shot. David Terrell's hurt. No, great fortitude of a chin. Good, great. You know, he's dropping his head, though. Those knees are just dangerously close. David Terrell, after he finishes exchange of his hands, does not drop his head. Tiki's seeing that, and he's a very savvy striker.
Both men have drawn blood. This is a great pace fight with a buck 45 to go here in round number one.
Tiki taking the back on the corner. Maybe, you know, he sees an opportunity here to maybe do something with the ground or catch a breather. David Terrell staying on the knees, not giving up the hooks.
Tiki's just looking at shots. Anything's open to him.
I think Tiki's experience, you know, it's about twice as many fights. I think it's really starting to show here. Those are good knees and ribs. That's just taking out the air.
Looks like a referee, Herb Dean's getting ready to stand him up.
Yeah, just, you know, sometimes the fighters, you know, you take a break, you sit there. Sometimes getting hurt, the hit doesn't hurt as bad as your lungs are.
Yep.
So you tend to sit there until, you know, you hear the referee's warning, you're going to start moving.
Under a minute to go here in round number one of this welterweight bout. Tiki on top right now in the black and red trim. That is David Terrell on the bottom, and he is just taking shots. There it is. They're going to stand him up. Herb Dean, our referee, just says I'm going to stand him up.
Too many shots to the back of the head right there. You know, you got to be able to protect, you know, the base of the spine is just not a target area optional for us here in the WEC. So anytime, you know, you're warned, a few shots can slip, but, you know, we're just going to protect the fighters. It's too dangerous of a shot. Pace definitely slowed down a little bit. Dave Terrell throwing a nice straight left hand, fading back.
Under 10 seconds to go, and Tiki comes in with a great exchange.
There's a fake knee. He got David Terrell to drop his hands. Came over the top of the right hand, followed up with another knee.
That's it. We'll have round two right after this short break. Welcome back to the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada. It's WEC Wreckage, and for all things concerning the WEC, check out our website, WEC.tv. Right now, let's go back inside the cage.
Let's do it.
All right, this is round number two, welterweight bout. If you had to give that one to someone, who are you giving it to?
Tiki. Tiki definitely dominated that fight. That
he
first round.
Pushed the pace from the get-go.
He did. You know, Dave Terrell's landing those straight lefts right there again. Landing it, but he's, you know, that's all it really he's mustered offensively right now. Tiki's landed punches, knees, you know. And he's also nullified the wrestling of Dave Terrell.
Tiki comes in with two quick lefts, snapping them off. No contact made, and it's Tiki back on the offensive again.
Yeah, Dave Terrell's really found a groove with that left hand. I would go ahead and maybe sink a little more hip into it and go for the knockout.
All right, what do you think Chuck Liddell told Dave Terrell?
Left's landing, throw a right hook afterwards.
And Tito Ortiz, what's he telling Tiki?
Keep doing what you're doing.
Simple. Keep it simple.
Nice straight left. Maybe slip a little bit side to side. Dave Terrell hasn't shown any kicks. That straight left, you know, from a southpaw to orthodox stance,
right?
It's like an inside pitch. It's hard to pick up. So you know what? The best way to do it is just move your head around. He's been caught a lot. Right now, Dave Terrell's winning this round. He's landed all the...
And Tiki's in trouble.
He's in big trouble. Oh, he's in trouble.
Dave Terrell is pouncing now. Tiki survives this, it'll be a miracle. Dave Terrell is just teeing off on him.
Dave Terrell's doing a great job.
Down again.
Oh. Dave Terrell's hands just keep moving. This fight's over. Fatigue. Tiki's just holding on like a champ. Look at that.
Tiki dancing away, and Dave Terrell just continues to throw.
Phenomenal.
Unbelievable WEC action.
What a win.
Herb Dean finally says enough.
Herb Dean protected the fighter. Tiki was in there. No way was he knocked out, but you know what? He wasn't going to come back from that. Only outlook at that was a vicious knockout. Dave Terrell was cutting him down. Very intelligent stoppage.
Unbelievable.
the straight left. It was landing. Like I said, put more hip behind it. He did it. And just, you know, right here, it was all heart. He was tired. His hands, both guys. That's, wow. You know what? That's two warriors going at it. Tiki was not going down. The referee had to stop the fight. That's when a fighter, you know what, too brave for his own good. Much respect to both guys. Dave Trell easily might not have been able to finish that knockout. A lot of guys would have called it quits and been gassed.
Let's go to Joe Martinez for our official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, 1 minute, 46 seconds of round number two. Referee Herb Dean steps in and calls a halt to the bout. For your winner by technical knockout, the pride of Las Vegas, Nevada, Dave the Bionic Terrell!
Coming up next in the featured bout of the night, Urijah Faber takes to the cage to defend his featherweight title against Joe Pearson.
Strap your helmet on and get ready for pain.
Come on and hit me, but just prepare to get hit back.
Coming up, Faber versus Pearson on WEC Wrekcage. Welcome back to WEC Wrekcage, World Extreme Cage Fighting, showcasing the best fighters and bringing you the most exciting mixed martial arts action in the world.
This one's for a belt. Joe Pearson brings his 17-7 record all the way from Iowa to Las Vegas, Nevada, where he looks to take home a belt back to the Midwest. Here he comes out of the Militich camp, and as we know, anyone that comes out of that camp is no slouch. He will be going up against Urijah Faber, 16-1 out of Sacramento, California. This kid is the complete package, no question about it. At 16-1, he is a near perfect in this world featherweight class, the WEC. Both men looking to go the distance, both men thinking they've got the abilities to knock the other man out.
It's gonna be pretty one-sided. I think I should be able to dominate in all aspects of the fight game.
You know, if he makes a mistake standing up, I'm gonna catch him. If he wants to go to the ground and take me down, I'm gonna catch him there. He's gonna decide how he loses.
I hope he tries to submit me, because you know, he's gonna be eating punches and probably get submitted himself.
Strap your helmet on and get ready for pain.
Come on and hit me, but just prepare to get hit back.
Entering the joint here at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada, Joe Pearson. They call him the Triangular Strangler. A strong 17-7 pro record as he brings it into the cage. Joe Pearson set to go 145, 5'10, fighting out of Iowa. And as the fever pitch begins to build here at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Urijah Faber is entering the joint. He stands 5'6 at 144 at weigh-ins, and he has not an ounce of fat on. This kid is cut.
No, everybody's one of the better builds in our sport. I mean, really is a well-conditioned athlete. I mean, wrestled Division I, a wrestling coach up there in Northern California, Sacramento, at UC Davis. I mean, I really got to get the wrestling to the edge to this guy. I mean, he's a great athlete. Really technical, and I mean, you just look at the guy. I mean, you can tell that he puts the time in the gym. I mean, this guy lives there. I don't know. I haven't changed his address, you know.
Urijah Faber, they call him the California Kid. He is smart. He is strong. He is powerful. As Frank mentioned, he is a former coach at UC Davis, where he was a wrestler, a very good wrestler at UC Davis at the Division I level. His only loss coming from Tyson Griffin, and here's a guy at 16-1 who. He's just controlling this featherweight division in the WEC.
No, he is. I think he's a force to be reckoned with right now. I mean, the only thing is, it'd be an interesting matchup. I don't see either guy really maybe with the striking being their strong points. I mean, everybody's well-versed in everything. But I think Urijah Faber's attributes are the takedown, getting on top. And Joe Pearson looks like he has a great guard.
As we take a look at the tail of the tape, both men in the cage, 27 and 28 respectively for Faber and Pearson. The reach is really what stands out. 70-inch reach for Pearson, 66.5. But as you pointed out, the reach can be completely wiped away with a good clean takedown.
Yeah, once you guys shoots a double on you, you know what I mean? I mean, it does help out if you're a little longer. I mean, we've seen with a sprawl, you have a good leverage, you can get down on it. But it's not as a deciding factor as it is in boxing, where, you know, we're throwing punches, 2 inches is going to count. Here, not so much.
since this is a title fight, we are going five-minute rounds.
All right, here we go. You ready? You ready? Bring it on!
And we are underway, a title fight here at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino for the WEC. And right off the bat, Urijah Faber wants to push the pace.
Nice little duck under.
Oh! A devastating drop to Pearson. If once good is two enough, not the case. Pearson gets out.
And that was actually very excellent. Urijah Faber came up to do a slam on him, picked him up. Joe Pearson did a great job. Open your guard. That's the athletic ability of Urijah Faber. You see the explosive. I mean, we've seen takedowns tonight, but those takedowns are hurting.
Less than a minute into this scheduled five-round fight, and Urijah Faber is just going at Pearson.
I see now if Joe Pearson starts working his guard a little bit, I think he needs to go ahead. He's going good wrist control, pushing for triangles.
Faber working that elbow in there on Pearson.
One thing about Faber really does have in his corner is that he trains with Kasio Vernet, who's a phenomenal jiu-jitsu guy, especially from the bottom. So I don't think he's going to be totally out of his element seeing triangles and arm bars coming from the bottom. You see right now a little bit of difference in Joe Pearson. That's a height advantage there that he's using. See how he's closing the guard. It's open right now, but a second ago he closed it using a triangle or a figure four across the midsection. Great way to draw a lot of breath out of your opponent. Nice, short, vicious elbows.
Faber is a complete buzzsaw here in the first round. This will be amazing if it goes the full five. And Faber told me, I trained six full rounds just for this kind of thing. Another pickup and drop on Pearson.
No, definitely. Urijah Faber is aggressive nature. He's landing some good shots. But again, he's in the guard. Joe Pearson's doing a good job of defending himself. And nothing really devastating has landed as of yet.
The speed at which Urijah Faber works is just unbelievable. How do you train for that?
A lot of it is you got to thank mom and dad, you know? Really, you do. He's a gifted athlete. He's strong. He's fast. And on top of that, he's disciplined and he cultivates the gifts that he's been given in the gym.
Faber shared a great story with us earlier in the week about how he was born in kind of a hippie setting, born in his house. Hippie no more as a young man gets his degree from UC Davis, and now he is just putting a clinic on Joe Pearson.
He is. He's doing a lot of damage from within the guard. Those shots are hurting. Tapping. He tapped out. He's done.
And that's it. Pearson is tapped out. Faber was unaware of it.
Stay there, man. Just stay there. We'll have a doctor look at you.
The eye is a part of the body that even a trained fighter, when it's in damage, it makes you not want to fight.
So it is Urijah Faber imposing his will, not spending any extra energy. Let's take a look at this one more time, Frank. What did you see here?
I see it right now. He's working. It looked like the elbow. You know what? It was a hard shot, but I didn't really see it go in the eye. I got to be honest with you. I don't see any fingers or anything in there in that shot right there. The elbow's a hard part of the body. It's easy to do a lot of destruction with it.
Faber barely breaking a sweat, but for Joe Pearson, it is all about pain, and he certainly received his fair share of it tonight.
I gotta say, if it's training for Urijah Faber, you might want to train with a chimpanzee or a monkey or some crazed animal to get used to what it's like to fight with someone with that athletic ability and that intensity. That was, he didn't just come out to coast. That guy was trying to finish the fight in the first 5 seconds.
So Joe Pearson's bid for the belt is quickly halted as the California kid Urijah Faber successfully defends his title with a dominating first round performance. Urijah Faber, your featherweight champion. So another great night of fighting at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino comes to a conclusion, and the WEC is certainly here to stay. On behalf of my colleague Frank Meir, I'm Todd Harris saying so long from Las Vegas. This is WEC Wrekcage, the World Extreme Cage Fighting.